Have you ever wandered lonely through the woods? Everything there feels just as it should. Part of a life there, you're part of something good. Have you ever wandered lonely through the woods? Ooh. Have you ever wandered lonely through the woods?
Have you ever stared into a starry sky? Lying on your back, you're asking why?
Well, good morning. My name is Matt. I hope you enjoyed that updated, sort of adapted version of that video, which we normally do here on Sunday mornings. That was really great. Well, again, welcome, and thank you so much for joining us for worship this morning. I just want to encourage you to engage in any way that you feel comfortable. Make use of the chat section there. Let us know you're here. Send us your prayer request. Take notes, however you feel led, just to make the most of this time that we have together. I just want to start by reading, sort of as a call to worship, something that is taken from several psalms and I think is appropriate as we begin this morning. Let everything that has life, let everything that has breath give all the glory and honor and praise to the one who overcame death. Let every living thing sing of the mercies of our God. Let us exalt him wherever we live with thanksgiving and joy in our hearts. If we don't praise him, the mountains will. If we don't exalt him, the rocks will cry out in our stead, God is not dead. Let every living thing sing of the mercies of our God. Let us exalt him wherever we live with thanksgiving and joy in our hearts.
Welcome, Commonway. Welcome to the Ritchie Farm. Welcome to our home and worship from the dining room here. So excited to be with you guys this morning and sing a little bit. Was thinking about the set list for this week, and this song came to mind. And it's actually a song, I don't do this very often, but it's a song that I wrote a long time ago, and I wrote it basically as a reminder to myself that sometimes you need to just slow down and let go. And in times of difficulty, when stresses are super heightened, I'll often go and think of this song and sometimes sing it. So it's called Pleasant Dreams. When we were young, we would dress like heroes that we loved. In our minds, we could visit far off lands. And we vowed that the day never would it come when we need more than stones in our hands, yeah. All these days go by fast as we race to the top, find the quick fix, shortcuts, and play to win. We no longer dream, barely exist, and we fear for the new days to begin. Oh, we fear for the new begin. Oh, I'll close my eyes. Did you with all of the riches one could ever dream, though they're clothed in envy's spell. That more, it could never be enough, and too little's much worse than it seems. I close my eyes and bid you my farewell, and I'll wish you pleasant dreams. Oh, I wish you pleasant dreams, yeah. Tonight I go to bed in the cool summer's air. For tonight I walked outside and looked at my God. I saw his face in the stars and the moon, and inside I can feel his peace. So pleasant dreams to you, my friends, to the ones I know least unwell. With all of the riches one could ever dream, though they are cloaked in envy's spell. That more, it could never be enough. And when too little's much worse than it seems, I'll close my eyes and bid you my farewell. And I wish you pleasant dreams. Yeah, I wish you pleasant dreams. Yeah, yeah. To you, my friends, pleasant come to you in prayer. Lord, have mercy. When I wonder if you're there, Lord, have mercy. When I cannot find the way, Lord, have mercy. Should my heart begin to stray, Lord, have mercy. When I lay me down to sleep, Lord, have mercy. When the road ahead gets steep, Lord, have mercy. When I falter, when I fail, Lord, have mercy. May your kindness still prevail, Lord, have mercy. Whoa. When I see your promises, Lord, have mercy. Knowing well that I am blessed, Lord, have mercy. May I never cease to ask, Lord, have mercy. Till I breathe my very last, Lord, have mercy. Whoa, whoa, whoa,
Good morning. My name is Jeremy. I'm one of the pastors here at Commonway. And in just a moment, we're going to pray together. But before we do that, I just want to point out that there are still a few ways, even though we're not here together in this room this morning, that you can share with us, the pastors and the staff, your prayer requests. One of those ways is you will see right now in the bottom right corner of your screen, if you're on Church Online, there is a button that says Live Prayer. And if you click on that, that will open up a private chat with one of us. And we will be there waiting and ready to pray with you this morning. And then another way, and this is open throughout the entire week, is you can go to our homepage, commonwaychurch.com, and if you scroll down just a tiny little bit, you will find a link for prayer requests. And in there, you can share your name and your prayer, and we'll be looking forward to hearing from you and praying with you and for you throughout the week. So I know that a lot of us are experiencing different things, whether that's with family or issues with work and finances. So please do not hesitate to reach out to us and share with us how we can be praying for you. And with that, let's pray together right now. Father, we thank you for your goodness. We thank you for your grace. And God, we thank you that even though we are together, not here, but in one spirit and in one mind and in one heart, that you are with us. And so, Father, we ask that even in this moment that we would each experience your presence wherever we may be. God, that you would be with us, with our family, with our friends, with our community. And Father, we ask that you would continue to go behind us and before us and beside us, that you would keep us safe, that you would keep us healthy. And Lord, together we pray that prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our sins as we forgive those who have sinned against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Good morning, Commonway. My name is Jennifer Stanley, and I'm so glad we can worship together this morning. Welcome to my kitchen, where my husband does most of the cooking, if we're being honest. I have just a few announcements, and the first one is how we can stay connected to each other and to everything that's going on in the life of our church during this time. And there are three primary ways, but the first is that you would just visit the homepage, commonwaychurch.com. We'll always have the latest information there. And while you're there, if you could select from the drop-down menu, the weekly and email subscriptions, we'd love to have you sign up for the weekly email that comes out, because it's a way that we know you're getting the information that we're trying to get to you. Also, we'd love for you to follow our social media on Instagram, Facebook. We have pages for Commonway Church and also Commonway Kids and Commonway Youth and Commonway College. So plenty of options there for staying connected and knowing what's going on. A few things that are going on that we're very excited about is that Commonway Kids and Commonway Youth are still meeting together. They are doing this through the Zoom app, and we just invite you to check out our homepage or the email or the social media to get all the information and details that you need to know for how to keep your kids connected to Commonway Kids or Commonway Youth. The Women's Ministry is also meeting. We've got a 5-week study that is starting this Wednesday morning at 9:30 a.m. And we would love to have any women in Commonway Church or beyond, anybody that just wants to feel connected and really dive into God's Word. We've got a 5-week study again starting this Wednesday. Just register and let us know you're coming. Last week's blood drive was such a huge success. We were able to donate 21 bags of blood in a completely isolated and one-on-one environment. It was so successful, as a matter of fact, that we're going to do it again, and that is going to be on April 2nd. You should have received an email this morning letting you know that that was happening, and it has a link to sign up for a specific time. This is a way that we can really be of service to our community in a very practical way right now. I've been thinking about how it feels like almost everything in our world has changed in the last 2 weeks. But there are a few things that really have not. People are still in need of hope. And we believe that the best place to find that hope is in Jesus. And so while things look a little different, we as a church are working really hard to keep connecting people with the hope of Jesus every single day. And so we just want to invite you to continue to be a part of that as we continue our giving as a church. And there are two ways that you can do that. You can mail a check to the office. You can teach your kids like how to use a stamp and everything. That's always a good idea. Or you can go online at commonwaychurch.com, or there's a button in the live screen that you're seeing now. Thank you so much for being a part of what we're doing. Thank you for being in our family. Thank you for worshiping with us this morning. Have a great morning, Commonway.
So, as we continue our Lenten series on prayer this morning, I want us to look at a few passages from the New Testament, things that the Apostle Paul writes about prayer to some different churches, people that he knew. So first of all, there is like what he writes about prayer, which is good and it's important. And you could say it's as needed today as ever. But then on top of that, there is also the context in which he says these things about prayer. There's what's happening around him. There are the circumstances and the difficulties in his life and issues that his fellow believers are facing. So there are all these challenges that Paul's teaching on prayer actually kind of flows out of, which for me adds a whole lot of weight and depth to what he's saying. Now, we sometimes forget, especially when it comes to New Testament epistles or letters, that these are letters written by real people in real places dealing with real life stuff. Have I said that to you before? Yes. Of course, these are first century people, which means they're dealing with circumstances that are oftentimes vastly different than our own context. In other words, they faced some difficulties, or you could say at times a level of suffering that a lot of times we have trouble relating to in our modern Western context. And so because of that, there are things written in the New Testament, things that Jesus says, things that Peter or Paul write about that are just kind of hard for us to fully connect with, especially when things are going well for us. I mean, the thing is, when we feel more or less in control or secure, when things are going well or at least okay, which, by the way, is how many of us were feeling just like a month or so ago. See, that's clearly not the default setting for Paul. It's not his typical experience. It's not the place he's usually writing from, which again makes it difficult at times for us to connect. It's harder for us to resonate with Paul in like a, yeah, I know exactly what you're talking about kind of way. And that's not bad. It's certainly not anyone's fault. It's just the way it is. Well, all of that said, every once in a while, and more frequently for some of us than for others, I get that, but for all of us right now with our current challenges and the uncertainties and the disappointments that we're facing, of course, we don't like it, but one of the things it does do is it does bring into perspective, for example, some of the things that Paul writes about prayer in the midst of his own anxieties and his own difficulties and uncertainties. It's in moments like these that that we're perhaps able to see some of these familiar passages in a new light. It suddenly becomes a whole lot more real and feels like a lot closer to home. Now, here's an example, which it actually leads into what Paul says about prayer. I saw a tweet a week or so ago along these lines, and it just got me thinking about this, and I haven't been able to let it go. In several of Paul's letters, he talks about being basically separated from people, from fellow believers, and these people he really cares about. So here's his letter to a church that he had planted in the Greek city of Thessalonica. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 17, Paul writes, "But, brothers and sisters, when we were orphaned by being separated from you for a short time, in person, not in thought, out of our intense longing, we made every effort to see you. For we wanted to come to you. Certainly I, Paul, did again and again, but Satan blocked our way." And so Paul's going, you know, I've been trying to visit, but things keep happening. Circumstances I can't control are preventing it. In the meantime, I haven't forgotten about you. I'm praying for you. And, you know, like the least I could do was send you this letter. In other words, this is the Apostle Paul saying, I had these plans. I mean, this is what I thought was going to happen, and obviously, it didn't work out like I thought. Just kind of wondering if anybody watching this right now can relate to that. A few verses later, he prays this prayer for them in chapter 3. He prays, "Now may our God and Father himself and our Lord Jesus clear the way for us to come to you." It's like Paul saying, enough with this letter writing stuff, which is better than nothing. But I'm praying that we could be together in person soon. Or how about this in Ephesians chapter 1, Paul writes, "For this reason, ever since I heard about your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love for all God's people, I have not stopped giving thanks for you, remembering you in my prayers." Again, we can't be together like we would like, he writes. He says, "I'm just so encouraged by what I'm hearing about you from a distance, and so I just keep praying for you." Paul, writing Timothy, he says, "I constantly remember you in my prayers, recalling your tears. I long to see you so that I may be filled with joy. I'm praying for you. I wish we could be together in person." Here's one more, Romans. To the Roman believers, chapter 1, verse 10, he says, "I pray that now at last, by God's will, the way may be open for me to come to you. I long to see you so that I may impart to you some spiritual gift to make you strong. That is, that you and I may be mutually encouraged by each other's faith. I do not want you to be unaware, brothers and sisters, that I planned many times to come to you, but have been prevented from doing so until now." So there are several more examples of this, but you're kind of getting the theme, like frustrated plans, separated. Paul wanting to be with these people that he cares about so they could encourage one another, but being unable to do so. Sound familiar? In the meantime, all he can do is pray. The point is, our current situation, it's like all of a sudden, Paul's circumstances are a whole lot more relatable. I mean, I say, and I can say to you like we say every Sunday, thank you so much for being with us. Or it was really great worshiping together as a church family. And that's true. And we mean that. But today, with a whole different set of circumstances, and I can look into this camera and I can say, like Paul, I long to see you. Like, I can't wait for us to be together again. Let's keep praying for each other. Let's keep encouraging each other in this uncertainty and in the meantime. See, now we are much closer to understanding a lot of Paul's context as he writes these letters. We realize, oh, these were real people dealing with real difficulties, some of which included having plans go out the window, but people who were nevertheless trying their best to stay connected, to be faithful in prayer, to encourage one another while being apart. So we have different technologies available today, but it's the same idea. And I am really grateful that we can gather like this online. And we recognize that this is, and what this is like simply our best substitute for being together in person. But I can't help but think if Paul could see this, what we're doing right now, that he would just be going, are you kidding me? This is incredible. I mean, we could just be writing letters, in other words. All right, all that said, I want to look at what Paul writes. Now, these same people he's separated from, and they're in their various communities going through their own challenges, their own frustrations and disappointments, facing their own uncertainties. And look what Paul says in a few places to them about prayer. And my prayer, as we look at this, is that our current less than ideal situation, that whatever difficulties and anxieties and fears that this is raising for you personally, that you will find what Paul goes on to say about prayer, that you will find that lands right where you are today in a very real and a very tangible, concrete way. So the first one I want to look at is 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. Again, that's what we started out, this same group earlier in this letter. He said, I've tried like so many times to come and see you. It's not working out. I'm praying for that day to happen. And then near the end of the letter, he writes this, rejoice always, pray continually, and give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Now, for us, when Paul says rejoice always, or, you know, give thanks in all circumstances, if we are honest, there's something within many of us, perhaps especially in a time like this, that goes, whoa, that's a little bit naive, or nice idea, but that doesn't work in real life. And what do you mean rejoice always, or give thanks in even these circumstances? And so it's understandable. We might be tempted to dismiss this as, I don't know, unrealistic, maybe even a little bit insensitive, you know, like, you don't know what I'm going through. And so these are words which we might be tempted to dismiss, except for then we remember who wrote them. We remember the context in which Paul is writing, the difficult circumstances these words actually come out of. And that, for me at least, is a whole lot harder to ignore. Paul repeats this theme later in his letter to the Philippians. Philippians chapter 4, verse 4, and this is where we're going to spend the rest of our time. Paul writes, rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again. Rejoice. Now you realize that for Paul, things like interrupted travel plans, you know, frustrated plans, that is only a very small part of the difficulties that he's been through and out of which he's able or decides to write something like this. In another letter, Paul recounts in 2 Corinthians, and these are his own words, he says, 5 times I received from the Jews the 40 lashes minus one. 3 times I was beaten with rods. 1 I was pelted with stones. 3 times I was shipwrecked. I spent a night and a day in the open sea. He just keeps going. I have been constantly on the move. I have been in danger from rivers, in danger from bandits, in danger from my own people, in danger from Gentiles, in danger in the city, in danger in the country, in danger at sea, and in danger from false believers. Just some of what Paul has been through. And on top of all of that, you need to know that as Paul writes these words, he's doing so chained in a prison cell awaiting, most likely, execution. Yet in spite of all this, Paul mentions joy. Actually, throughout the letter to the Philippians, he brings up the word joy 16 different times, just repeats it over and over. And again, I find it hard to, like, argue with the source. It's actually Paul's own life and story and the hardships that he faced that gives Paul and what he's saying here so much credibility. He's not talking about like fake it, happy. You've seen that. This is not just an empty cliche like, you know, rejoice in the Lord. I mean, in Paul's world, when you get thrown in prison, that is a bad thing. On top of that, if your job is to go around and to travel all over the place as an itinerant missionary church planter, and there are all these issues with churches, and believe it or not, churches are fighting amongst themselves and things, Paul needs to be there in person to help resolve, but you can't because you are on lockdown. That's a problem. Except Paul goes, oh, I'm in prison. I guess I'll talk to the guards about Jesus. They have to listen. Oh, and if only I could find something to write on. I believe some letters are in order. Paul says, choose joy. Not just as a feeling, but as an act of the will, as an act of your discipleship to Jesus. I do think it's worth pointing out then that joy, that rejoicing in the scriptures is clearly not for people for whom everything has gone well. Joy apparently has nothing to do with health or wealth or our plans or any of the things working out that we think need to work out for us to be happy or whole. Rejoicing in the scriptures, often it is people who've suffered the most who have the greatest joy. And so Paul's saying here, I want you to reflect on God's goodness. Reflect on his mercy in your life. Allow the unbelievable reality of what God has done for you. Allow that to sink in until you actually begin to feel some of the emotion associated with this, until your emotions catch up with this unbelievable reality. He goes on, the next verse, verse 5, let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Okay, so gentleness. What does that have to do with any of this? Some scholars suggest that graciousness is actually a better translation. But Paul is essentially saying to these Philippian believers, you are experiencing difficulty. You are experiencing perhaps some opposition. Maybe not everyone is thrilled with all of this Jesus talk. Perhaps some even have it out for you. And Paul is saying, don't let your circumstances determine how you will treat people. Let your gentleness, let your graciousness be shown to all people. When you find yourselves stressed out, back against the wall, under pressure, whatever it is, may love, may grace, graciousness, may gentleness flow out of you. Because, he says, the Lord is near. God, in other words, is up to something even in this. He's near. He hasn't gone anywhere. Next verse. Do not be anxious about anything. All right, here we go. The word anxious, also the word worry, both in the original language have reference to strangling or like being choked, which kind of describes how we feel when we're anxious, that like things have us by the throat and seem to be cutting off our life. Now, he's going to give us some help in just a second on how we're to do this. But I just want to stop and ask, what are you anxious about? What are you afraid of right now? What's sort of in the back of your mind or in the forefront gnawing at you? I'm sure a lot of us are anxious in these days about, for example, our finances, as it relates to our jobs and the economy and the future there and just, you know, how bad is it going to get and, you know, what will this mean for life as I know it? Perhaps you're worried about someone you love and their health. I mean, what's going to happen tomorrow? I mean, how many of you, and you don't have to raise your hands at home, but how many of you at some point in the past month, you have found yourselves lying in bed at night, unable to like turn your mind off because of all these anxieties and stresses and unknowns and pressures. Yeah, I bet a lot of us. Do not be anxious about anything. But in every situation, by prayer and petition, so as we've been saying in this series, we bring these things, these concerns to God, whatever we're worried about, by prayer and petition with thanksgiving. This is actually really important. And one of the things that's so easy to lose sight of when anxiety creeps in are all the ways that God has been faithful to us in the past. Like our minds just short circuit and we forget. So with thanksgiving, has God ever abandoned you in the past? No. Has God ever failed to provide and to care for you and give you what you need for that day or that season again? No. And so prayer, rooted in gratitude, rooted in awareness that God has led you this far and has yet to fail you. You have much, I have much to be grateful for. And remember, this is Paul writing this in circumstances that you would think he would just have nothing to be thankful for. And yet he's full of gratitude and joy. With thanksgiving, he goes on, present your requests to God. Now, this just kind of reminds me, this imagery here of kind of an obscure passage in the Old Testament where there's the king of Judah, his name is King Hezekiah, and someone hands him a letter from like their number one enemy, the king of Assyria. And in the letter, the king of Assyria is basically making all kinds of very clear threats and saying, I'm on the way to destroy you and to crush Judah and Jerusalem and, you know, all these terrible things. And so he gets this letter, and it's also worth noting that this king of Assyria can and will like back this up. These are not just empty threats. I look at 2 Kings 19 and what Hezekiah does. Hezekiah received the letter from the messengers, which came from the king of Assyria, and read it and freaked out, I'm sure. And then he went up to the temple of the Lord and spread it out before the Lord. And Hezekiah prayed to the Lord. Hezekiah gets this terrible news, like on paper or parchment, and he goes and he literally opens or like unrolls this letter before the Lord. And he prays. He says, God, look at this. And he prays that God hear his concerns and see them. I think that's a lot of what Paul's getting at when he says, present your request to God. Lord, here's what I need. Here's what's keeping me up at night. Here are what I'm anxious about. You know, it could be for you just maybe an exercise or a discipline here in this. Maybe it's literally like Hezekiah did, like spreading out the papers in front of you and saying, God, please look at this. God, here is a pile of bills and I have no idea how they're going to get paid. God, here's my calendar. And as I look at it, there are a lot of blanks where there would have been appointments, showings, bookings, clients, etc. This is not looking good. Lord, here are my test results. I'm scared. A week or so ago, I came across something I'd never read before by C.S. Lewis. He wrote an essay called On Living in an Atomic Age. It was written in 1948. So just some context, World War II was over. And of course, you know, the nuclear bombings in Japan had happened. And it was also the beginning of the Cold War. And just keep in mind where Lewis lives, London, right? Which had been, like your city had been bombed in air raids. And there's all this growing tension between Russia and communism and the West. And there's this daily threat of like, now nuclear annihilation, because we have entered into this new kind of scary era. And so Lewis writes about this anxiety that people in his day were feeling. And obviously our situation today is like totally different, but you're going to see there are some, I think, very relevant connections. So I want to share this. The language is a little bit kind of old, but you'll get it. It's also a super long quote, but I promise you it is so, so worth it. So here we go. Lewis writes, "In one way, we think a great deal too much of the atomic bomb. How are we to live in an atomic age? I am tempted to reply, why, as you would have lived in the 16th century when the plague visited London almost every year, or as you would have lived in a Viking age when raiders from Scandinavia might land and cut your throat any night, or indeed, as you are already living in an age of cancer, an age of syphilis, an age of paralysis, an age of air raids, an age of railway accidents, an age of motor accidents. In other words, do not let us begin by exaggerating the novelty of our situation. Believe me, dear sir or madam, you and all whom you love were already sentenced to death before the atomic bomb was invented. And quite a high percentage of us were going to die in unpleasant ways. We had indeed one very great advantage over our ancestors, anesthetics, but we have that still. It is perfectly ridiculous to go about whimpering and drawing long faces because the scientists have added one more chance of painful and premature death to a world which already bristled with such chances, and in which death itself was not a chance at all, but a certainty. This is the first point to be made, and the first action to be taken is to pull ourselves together. If we are all going to be destroyed by an atomic bomb, let that bomb, when it comes, find us doing sensible and human things." And he gives a list: praying, working, teaching, reading, listening to music, bathing the children, playing tennis, chatting to our friends over a pint and a game of darts, not huddled together like frightened sheep and thinking about bombs. They may break our bodies. A microbe can do that. But they need not dominate our minds. Let me just read that last sentence again. They may break our bodies. A microbe can do that. But they need not dominate our minds. Yeah. A virus is very different from an atomic bomb and calls for a much different response. So just to be clear, I think Lewis today would affirm, you know, our current precautions and the steps that were taken to flatten the curve and all of that. But I share this because whether it's the atomic bomb or COVID-19 or whatever else, I mean, these things remind us that we're human, that we're mortal. I actually find strange comfort in that line when he says in there, "Believe me, you and all whom you love were already sentenced to death before the atomic bomb was invented." Because, like, big picture, we trust in Jesus. Our life is in him, resurrection life. And so in the meantime, Lewis's point, borrowed from Paul, borrowed from Jesus, is we don't need to live in fear. I mean, like Paul says again and again, rejoice. We can live and we can choose joy. We can still choose gratitude. We can still bring our requests, our anxieties, our fears to a loving God who cares for us, who is as close as the air around us. And here's the promise. "And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding." And the peace of God. Notice he doesn't say here that the peace of circumstances. I mean, we all know circumstantial peace. That's called when everything works out great. I had peace because things went my way or whatever. That's the peace of circumstance. That, by the way, always changes because it's always dependent on how well things are going. That's not what he's talking about here. Experiencing the peace of God is not dependent on circumstance. It's actually bigger than even try not to worry. We've all tried not to worry. That doesn't work. What he's getting at is this truth that our anxieties actually have to be displaced. They actually have to be pushed out by something greater. The peace of God, which we actually can't even fully explain. It has to be experienced. The peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Now, the Philippian believers that are getting this letter, when he says that word guard, they know instantly what he's talking about because they're a Roman colony, which means there is 24/7 a Roman garrison, a group of soldiers constantly on guard around the city, keeping the Pax Romana, keeping the Roman peace. And so Paul uses this language familiar to them and says, the peace of God will stand guard around your hearts and your minds. And this is really important because, of course, you know, we want God to like stand guard around our job, right? We want God to guard our source of income or to stand guard over our kids or over some circumstance. Again, tied to circumstances, though. What we are actually offered is much deeper than that. So my question as we wrap this up, what if you allowed God to stand guard around your heart and your mind? What if you could have peace? I mean, think about this. Peace in spite of the fact that for some of us, there is more uncertainty right now than perhaps we've ever experienced before in our lives. What if we learned to bring these anxieties to Him? To pray with honesty, with vulnerability, with thanksgiving? What if we prayed until we actually found joy and peace in Him? A joy and a peace that was unrelated and therefore not dependent on our circumstances. I'm just saying, what if we stayed on our knees, not until the world changes, not until you're released from prison or whatever it is, it might never happen. I mean, what if we prayed until we could admit to God, God, the reason that I'm so anxious right now and the reason that I'm so restless is because I guess I've never really learned to trust you. Kind of been putting it all in my circumstances. I've never actually perhaps even had to trust you like I'm having to do right now. I mean, that sounds like a small thing, but I'm telling you, that is huge. Because what happens is you allow God to take you there, you will emerge into this same chaotic, uncertain world. But you're going to have something that you didn't have before. You're going to have the peace of God, which surpasses all human comprehension. I mean, that means that people literally won't get it. That people will look at you like, are you in denial? You seem like everything is okay. So everything worked out then. No, you know, actually, it's way worse or whatever. Because you have peace. You have peace that is not tied to any circumstance. And actually, many of you watching this, because I know a lot of you in your stories, you have experienced the peace of God, exactly what he's talking about. In the midst of extremely difficult situations, just heartbreakingly difficult moments or perhaps even whole seasons of your life. You've experienced this mystery. Perhaps the circumstances themselves, maybe they didn't change, maybe they even got worse, but God did something in you that it's hard to even explain, that took the focus almost off the circumstances in the first place. Again, I don't know exactly how it all works. I just know that God promises to do this if we'll bring our fears and our anxieties to him. That we can experience peace that goes beyond our circumstances, whatever it is we're going through. Heavenly Father, we come before you and we present to you these concerns, these anxieties, these things that have come to the surface or that we've been living in these recent days. Lord, I pray that you would help us, even in that, to experience unexplainable joy. That even in that, we could be in touch with a feeling of gratitude, all that you've given us, all that you have done for us, including your constant faithfulness to us throughout every moment of our lives. Thank you. We present our requests and our concerns to you now. And may we receive back not only assurance that you hear, that you see what we're going through, that you love us, but may we receive this peace that surpasses our understanding. Peace that is not tied to or dependent on any circumstance or outcome. May we receive that now as we move forward. Thank you. It's in Jesus' strong name that we pray. Amen. Well, again, thank you so much for joining with us, for worshiping together as a church family. May the peace of God, which is beyond your comprehension, surround you and stand guard around your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. We'll see you next week.